Hello, I'm Scott Porter, a marine biologist in the Northern Gulf of Mexico. As an invasive coral biologist, one of my favorite places to dive used to be the main pass block of rigs, which lie just east of the Mississippi River. This area used to be known for its crystal blue waters, which were not typically affected by the Mississippi River's output. These underwater oases grow under offshore oil and gas installations, and are part of the world's largest chain of artificial coral reefs that exist here in the Northern Gulf. Exploring these uncharted reefs is like an undersea odyssey, reminding me of Alice in Wonderland, where we have the opportunity to learn something new on every dive. Even though on most of those dives I have to keep an eye out for barracuda and sharks, of course. It's worth it though, because sometimes you get some really good shots like these two butterfly fish. Notice that I said it used to be one of my favorite diving spots. And it was one of my favorite spots before the Macondo well blowout. With close to 300 million gallons of oil and over 2 million gallons of dispersant placed in the Gulf waters, it literally makes me sick to dive there. These are a few of the dispersed oil images that we have from Main Pass 311 in August 2010. As you can see, the Main Pass block lies just north of the MC-252 Macondo well, which is about 40 miles north of the well and 20 miles east of the river. These are a few of the images that were captured in June of 2010. Burning oil in the background, fresh red oil on the surface of the water. Yes, that is a diver in the water, and no, it is not me. It is a reporter that we took out diving with us, who said he would pay for any gear that he ruined. That's our gear, by the way. The gear was never paid for, but we did end up with a few interesting shots out of it. But they never carried on the discussion about the dispersed oil and the plumes that we were seeing under the surface, and what was the true fate of the oil. Where was it going to go? How would it truly affect us? I suppose to set the stage, we should go back and look at what the area looked like before the spill. And this is it. Please note the clarity of the clear blue water. This was an average day and not exceptional conditions, and we still have visibility close to 100 feet. Let's go deeper and see what we can find. Ah, Queen Angelfish. Or is it the Townsend Angel? Either way, I think this is her spot. Did you know that jellyfish can swim? Well, this one does. Don't worry about getting too close. It doesn't have stinging tentacles. Now let's go looking under Main Pass 311 in June, right after the spill, 2010. This is what it looks like, diving through the plumes. The dispersed oil seawater solution plumes that these upper reef organisms are forced to live in. Diving through this first 30 feet of water is like diving through clouds in the sky. Except these clouds are white, green, and brown. And oh yeah, toxic. Now who can tell us about the fate of these organisms? What about these coral reefs? What's going to happen to them? Will they live or will they die once they're contaminated? And likewise, what is the fate of this school of fish, which appear to be trying to avoid the toxic plume? This school of fish was down at 60 feet, where we were collecting coral samples. The sample is collected. Time for further investigation. Here we come. Let's see what else we can find. These red fish with yellow tails that we see here are a very hardy species of hawgrass. They're too fast to catch. Let's see something slower. Wow, what do we have here? Lobster, anyone? But seriously, after seeing the environment these organisms are living in, the safety of their meat has to be in question, even if it is lobster, but especially because it's lobster. Therefore, we'll just take a representative sample of his tissue and let him go. As the camera pans around, we find a school of another very hardy species of surgeon fish called a doctor fish. Calling Dr. All come, Dr. All come. Moving on, I think it's interesting that it is noon and we still need our lights underneath the platform. This barracuda usually asks me, what am I doing here? Now I think he's asking me, what have we done here? Also in the plumes were long, mucus-like strands of dispersed oil. These strands were suspended at different levels of the water column, and if you swam through them, they would definitely stick to you. Now we're back in the same main pass 311 zone, in August of 2010, looking at the same rig. Doesn't even look like the same area, does it? Notice how thick the plume is now. It's hard to look back now and think about what we were swimming in. Thank goodness I was wearing my dry suit on this day. Notice how dense the plume was on this first 30 feet as we descend through it. Now at this point, I am less than 5 or 6 feet away from the camera, and it can still hardly pick me up. Now please remember, this is 24 days after they supposedly capped the well. So what's going on? Does this stuff staying around, hanging around in the water column longer than we thought or than we were told? It's hard to get over just how thick this plume was, and 40 feet deep. And finally, around 40-45 feet, we reach water clear enough to film in, as you will see here coming up. The camera will swing around and finally it can pick me up. And by the way, special thanks to Liquid Image for the video mask. It came in handy. Look at how dense the plume is down here at 50 feet. It's hard to believe it's the same place. Now the barracuda is not asking me, what have we done, but what the hell is going on here? I don't blame you, Mr. Barracuda. I want to know the same thing. What is going on here? And for the record, I was ill after diving at this spot on this day and experienced extreme nausea and dizziness, and welts appeared all over my body. And even though I did not dive the main pass block of rigs again until April 2011 when we returned with the Associated Press, we did return with the sampling team to this rig on September 12th, 2010.